I'm reading from Luke 16, 9 through 13. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little will also be trusted with very much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. You may be seated.
I have the privilege to discuss an important subject of stewardship. And when we have problems, and as we go to God in prayer, and which is really good, but we many times just say, Lord, what am I to do? Well, the emphasis then is on us instead of God. What we really want to ask is, Lord, what will you do through me? This is what we want to ask when we consider stewardship. Now, really, this is probably a review because I am so blessed and honored to be a part of this congregation. We have such a wonderful, giving congregation, and it's so generous. Now, with our new budget, it's going to take $28,000 to $29,000 a month to keep our church going, keep the outreaches going, and that's a lot of money, and yet it comes in faithfully each month. And since I've been a part of this congregation, we have re-roofed the sanctuary and the educational center. That was about $130,000 to $40,000, and that was all paid for. We did get behind on apportionments a little bit, and that was $41,000, but we caught that right up. And now we have the money to put a men's restroom up here by the sanctuary, which is greatly needed, especially when they have funerals and other things, and remodel the women's restroom. And that's another $70,000 to $75,000, and we have the money. So we have a wonderful, good, giving congregation. And so we are to be very much commended. And this is at a time when we're seeing a lot of other congregations closing. The funding and members both are drying up, and some of the other congregations are closing. And yet, this is a viable congregation. So why do we need to even think about stewardship? Well, the main reason is we're born imperfect, sinful, and our sinful nature is to be selfish. As one pastor said, one of the first words we learn as children, it's mine, 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 mine. Even parents get tired of hearing that. So it's just something we have to prayerfully think about at times because of our sinful nature. And besides our sinful nature, we're constantly bombarded by advertisements. You need the latest and the best thing right now. Get it now, you don't even have to pay anything. You get instant credit. And this is how a lot of people find themselves in trouble, is being able to get this. But what might help us be better stewards and to govern our money better, steward it better, is 1 Timothy 6, verse 6. It says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. We know this to be true. And so they help us. We realize how futile it is to keep accumulating things because we didn't bring anything in, and when we die, it's not going with us. It's going to be right here for somebody else to use. So we realize we're just using things here upon the earth while we're here. So contentment will help us be able to be better stewards and share what we do have to help other people. And then we can ask God, what will you do through me? When especially when we think about all the things we do here in our church, the outreaches in the community and stuff. So what is a good steward, we might ask? Well, a steward, as we read in Luke 16, is a manager of a household or estate that he does not own. It said there in Luke 16, verse 12, it says, and if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? So it's someone then that is accountable and serves someone else because they do not own the property. In our case, we recognize it's God who owns everything. He created it all. In fact, the next breath you take is a gift from God. You know, the mixture of gases in the air, there's like 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and water, 1 or 2% argon, is the right balance. If there was a lot more oxygen, everything would be so combustible that the earth would probably burn up. And it's made in such a way then that we can breathe. It didn't just happen. The air had the right mixture of gases to sustain our lives. And the earth, it's tilted 23.4 degrees. You know, that wasn't an accident. And we're 92,960,000 miles from the earth, it's from the sun. So we're the exact distance we need to sustain life. If the tilt wasn't there, the polar caps would freeze, the middle would burn up. If we were a little closer to the sun, we'd burn up. A little further away, we'd be an iceberg, the whole earth. So we see everything belongs to God. He created it. It shows intelligent design. If we go from the subatomic particles to the millions of galaxies full of sun, of stars, we see intelligent design. We owe God everything. Thus, if everything belongs to God, what are we to do as good stewards with our income and possessions? Well, let's notice in Exodus, the 23rd chapter, verse 19. Exodus 23:19, it says, bring the best of the first fruits of your soil to the house of the Lord your God. Notice, we're to bring, not give, but bring the first fruits, the first portion of our income, first portion of everything, the best, to the house of God. So that means we bring our tithe or 10% to bring God, to God, and then God can bless the rest of it. Then he can give it to you. Even though it belongs to him, therefore he can give it to you and bless that other 90%. So doing this will make us like God. The one scripture everybody knows and is so well known is John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Yes, as we look throughout Scripture, we see God as a giver, and he gave his very best, his Son, so that we can have eternal life. And as we read here in Exodus, the reason it's important to God is we brought the first fruits to the house of the Lord your God. So he wants us to bring it here to support pure, true worship. That was the temple in Jerusalem that was being supported there. For us, it's our church. And we realize that we have Pastor Bob that feeds us spiritually, helps us to grow spiritually, and we need to support that. And now with our vision, we're in the process of hiring a ministry assistant. And so they'll take care of us spiritually. We need that. We need to support a wonderful place and then all the outreaches it has. So that's why it's so important to God that we do continue being a generous congregation. And it shows we put God first. Remember in verse 13 that it said, no servant can serve two masters. And it went on to say, you cannot serve both God and money. So we're putting God ahead of money. This is what we want to do. Show that we put God first in our lives. Some in the world, they say they trust God, but then they really trust their job, their education, their savings, or even the government. I personally benefit greatly from Social Security. But do I trust in it? Absolutely not. I know that it could end tomorrow, especially since today's Sunday. Probably be tomorrow. But we know the country is in deep financial problems, and we can't trust that. So we have to put our trust in our Heavenly Father, who he rained down bread for over 2 million when they exited Egypt. He was able to provide food for them. So we don't need to get too concerned, but put our trust in our Heavenly Father. He's able to care for our needs. Putting God first also helps us prevent us from looking to money to give us things that it can't give, but promises to give. Money promises to give us identity, importance, significance, respect, freedom, happiness, security, a happy marriage. A lot of people think, well, I've had more money, then I can solve our marital problems. Nowhere in the scriptures will you find Jesus, people coming to him with their problems saying, you just need more money. No. He showed that he's the answer. Our Lord Jesus is the answer to all our problems. And this is what we want to keep in mind, that we therefore is why we want to support our church, our center of pure worship here in Clinton. Even to show the futility of money in the last recession, a lot of people that had retirement funds saw it vaporize and went back to work. They had no other choice. So you just cannot rely on money, only the Lord. Another reason to be good stewards, it shows our heart condition. In Matthew, the sixth chapter, verses 19 through 21, Jesus said, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where both moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So it's obvious that this congregation has made our church and its vision, its outreach is their treasure, because we see that this is where many are donating and supporting it very well. And as our vision said, it helps us then to worship passionately together. We have to be together. We have to come together as a congregation to keep our spiritual fire burning. And then we grow spiritually together. We need the congregation. And then uniting in prayer. With these, then we're equipped to impact the community and build up our families. Especially fathers who are responsible for their families. Still, some say, I don't have much, and when I get more, then I'll be able to give. Well, we have to remember Jesus' words at Luke 16, back to our verses 16, verse 10. And it said, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So first, God wants to see if we can be trusted to do the right thing with what we do have. Remember the situation where Jesus observed the temple and saw the widow just give her two little mites. But he said she gave out of her need and not her extra. You know, I have a little extra, I'll throw it in. No, she gave out of her very need. So it's real important that we show ourselves be trustworthy with what we have. But if we can't be, then we're basically stopping the blessings of God. How can he bless a person who won't show that they have concern for others more than themselves? Have to have that unselfishness in our hearts. Others say, I've worked hard for my money. And we established, first of all, it's not their money, that everything belongs to God. But let's consider the farmer. He can work hard all day long, planting, weeding, fertilizing, and doing all these things. But if God does not bring the rain and the sun at the right time, at the right amount, it's to no avail. It's futile if he works real hard. He has worked for nothing. The ground will not produce. It needs God's blessing. So the bottom line is, here in Luke, back in Luke 16, verse 11, it said, so if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? Well, what are true riches? True riches are people. They'll last forever. As John 3:16 said, they can have eternal life. Better, and they could have better lives now with Jesus in their lives. We want to help them. We want to help others. So remember, everything is God's. Even your next breath is a gift from him. Thus, we need to continue, as this congregation has already shown, to be good stewards, support us of worship in this vision we talked about. Peter walked on water, but first he had to get out of the boat. And so ask the Lord, what are you doing through me? Then take time to stop and listen. And maybe he is saying you can do more. And if he does, then you can step out of the boat and you also will walk on water. Thank you. Let's close in prayer. Sovereign Lord of the whole universe, our creator and life giver, we owe our very breath to you, everything we owe to you. And we're so thankful that you care for us and have created a beautiful earth full of many blessings and so many beauties and so much for us to enjoy. You created us to see in color, to taste the many variety of foods you created. You show that you are a loving God, and so we can put our trust in you. We cannot put our trust in this world. Help us always keep serving you and not money, to put you ahead of all things and to have a self-sacrificing attitude, our hearts being touched by what touches you, Lord. We realize that you always cared for the widow, the orphan, and the foreigner. And we realize that we too want to care for others that do not have the advantages that many have, that there is so much suffering in this world. But we have the answer. We have the kingdom of God in our hearts, and we want to be able to do your will, whatever that will is, and make it a part of our will. Help us then to do that, for we cannot do it on our own strength. We're so thankful that we have the Holy Spirit living within us to empower us to do things, to speak the words of your Holy Bible to others and help them to come to a close relationship with you, Lord. Realize that religion is not just what we want here. We want a relationship with you and with our brothers and sisters in like faith so that we can build each other up, that we can be strengthened to do your will and to suffer if we must, whatever comes our way. We realize we must deny ourselves and pick up the cross and follow you, Lord. So give us the strength to do that. Let's show more and more love for each other here in the congregation, and to show love for even those that have so little. Let's not be arrogant, but be humble servants. For Jesus has many names, but one that we sometimes forget is he came to serve. He's a servant, and we want to emulate him. Thank you for all these gifts that we've been blessed with, but help us to realize our blessings are to serve others with it and not be a dam, a reservoir, but to spill out and flow out the joy that we have in serving you to others and give them the hope that we have. So we send you our love. We pray forgiveness where we sin. We know we are sinners, and we're so thankful for the shed blood of Christ Jesus. And so this ability then to have be counted righteous in your sight, Lord. So we thank you for all these gifts. We pray again for your guidance and wisdom, and we send you our love in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.